So good afternoon, everyone. Thank you for joining on a Saturday afternoon to talk about an important topic. I think 18th of November this year was World COPD Day, and the theme this year was Living Well with COPD Anywhere, Everywhere. So we've decided to focus the webinar as well on that topic, and we are very pleased to have with us two very knowledgeable and experienced panelists. Let me quickly introduce Patients Engage. We are an online platform, and we have been operational for over 5 years. We're focused on evidence-based management of chronic conditions from the perspective of patients and family caregivers. And we strongly believe in the value of lived experiences and how being empowered and being engaged is very important for a better quality of life. We do these webinars regularly. And today, as I said, we have with us an extremely knowledgeable panel of Dr. Prahlad Prabhudesai, who's a chest physician and bronchoscopist who practices at his at Om Clinic in Goregaon, as well as at Leelavati Hospital in Mumbai. And we have Purvi Dhananisha, who's a respiratory therapist. And also hoping that we will shed some light on the role of a respiratory therapist, because it's not something that people know about. And quick guidance to the people who are watching us. The information here is not to be taken as a consultation. There is medical advice by the experts, but you know, we will not get into very specific issues. This session is being recorded. So if you're logged into Zoom, you can put your questions on the Q&A, you know, the tab that you will see at the bottom. And if you're on Facebook, you can post the questions on the live feed. I will be looking at the questions and picking them up and asking them during the session. If at any point, as always, if you have an experience to share in future, you can write into us at editor@patientsengage.com. And you can follow us on any of our social media sites, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, Instagram, as well as you can register on patientsengage.com and download our app from the Play Store. Let me quickly, let's quickly start, Doctor, by asking you what is COPD, and if you can talk about the main types of COPD.
Can I answer?
Sure, yes, that's for you, Doctor.
Chronic obstructive pulmonary disease, the name itself suggests that it's a chronic, it's an obstructive, and it's a lung disease in simple words.
Right.
So what is obstructive means the airway become narrow. Okay. Why they become narrow? Two reasons. One is there is a swelling in the airways, and that is because of the inflammation, which may follow by or which may happen following infection. And there is an inflammation which leads to swelling, mucus formation, and chronic inflammation, recurrent inflammation leads to a further thickening of the airways, narrowing of the airways, and you can say that it becomes lesser responsive to the medicines. So this is an airway disease, but it is very important to know the other important aspect is that obstruction also can happen because of the alveoli, which are very like grip-like structure, which are attached to the smaller airways at the terminal part of the airways. And these alveoli are very elastic. So they keep the underlying airway patent, open, because of the elastic forces. So this is just like a tent, okay? The alveoli is like a tent. You have the strings of the tent, and you put the tent's strings on the ground by nailing it, so that your tent is open. Okay, so suppose if you cut the tent, the ropes, and the tent will collapse. Similarly, when in emphysema, these alveolar walls, which are elastic, which make the airway open like that, they get cut and they get destroyed. So the airway become narrow. So this is very important thing about the in chronic COPD, that a significant number of the patient will have this destruction of the alveolar wall leading into the narrowing of the airways. That's one. Okay. Second important thing is that when the alveolar walls which get destroyed, these are the walls. These are actually what alveolar works does is that it passes oxygen into the RBC and carbon dioxide outside. And if the walls gets destroyed, then obviously a lot of capillaries are destroyed. So there is a loss of capillaries, loss of gas exchanging units. Okay, so this is one thing which is very important, and the whole alveoli will become like a dead ventilated area because there is no capillaries around, so that gas exchange doesn't happen. In short, in chronic bronchitis and COPD, you have got a bronchitis element and there's an emphysema element. Okay, so this is generally follows smoking, but it need not be always following smoking. You have non-smoker COPD also. If you are exposed to a lot of gases, a biogas, what we call, especially our females or who are cooking, okay, in the house, especially in the villages where they use the wood, etc., for preparing the food, because of the fumes and the gases which are produced, there is a, it's like a smoking, okay. So it causes the same pathology what smoker gets. Okay, and leads to the same pathology like obstruction and emphysema. The other reasons is pollution. Okay, and generally pollution means whatever the pollution we are exposed to cities, but not only that, occupations which can give pollutions, certain occupation who are not ventilated can also have more pollution, which can lead to the same pathology. Even in the house, if you are having agarbatti or you are mosquito coils, or if you are using air, the other mosquito repellent sometime. This also leads to a constant irritation to the airways, which can give rise to same pathology of what smokers get. Everything depend upon the underlying genes of the patient. Why? Because there in the human body, there are two pathologies happening. One is helping the lung to remain functional, and other is other genes are also which may promote more destruction of the lungs, like what house smokers happens. So when there's a balance, it is good. But if there's a balance is not maintained, then the genetic structure of the human that person can lead to worsening of the lung condition when they are exposed to this smoking and other pollution. So this is the crux of COPD, in simple words, how the COPD is basically, what is COPD is like this, okay? And obviously, as very nicely put on this slide, the important complaints are chronic cough, sputum, chest tightness, wheezing, and in some patients, because of the constant breathlessness, they lose weight, okay, as well.
Right. Thank you, doctor.
So, Dr. Prabhudasai, is asthma a COPD?
No, asthma is another allergic disease where the bronchospasm and the swelling inflammation to the airways, which also happens in the COPD, but this inflammation is allergic in onset, allergic in to begin with. And so this is called eosinophilic disease, okay? So eosinophils are generally high in asthma, and the airways are inflamed because of the eosinophils inside. So it's type of eosinophilic bronchitis, but asthma is a completely different than COPD. That's very important to know, because our concept of treatment is also different. Your diagnostic method is also different. So asthma is a different disease, though it affects the airways like in COPD.
Okay, thank you. Can you have the next slide, Aparna?
Can you see the next slide?
Yes.
Okay. Do we need the next slide or this one?
This is a very nicely shown lungs of a smoker and a non-smoker lung. You can say this is a very healthy lung. You can say that who hardly has exposed to a smoke or even a pollution. That's why the lung is looking like a pink lung. Okay, the infant's lung is like this. Okay. Who is never exposed to pollution, so pink lung, and this is the end stage of a chronic smoker. How the lung look? This is all black, which is nothing but the smoke particles okay, carbon particles inside, okay, and even the sputum also will become black sputum. Yeah, this is all the aspects we discussed, the causes and risk factors of chronic bronchitis, smoking, pollution, fumes, then childhood recurrent infection, which also leads to bronchitis. Some, they have mentioned asthma, because some of the asthma patients who are chronic, okay, who become long-term asthmatic, who doesn't take adequate treatment, they behave like a COPD, but they are not exactly COPD. The treatment is one of the etiological. Very few people say that uncontrolled asthma can lead to COPD. But remember, in COPD, there is an emphysema part, which is very important, which asthma generally do not get emphysema. It's only airway disease. Okay? But it is, yes, they behave like COPD. So that's why there's always a doubt whether this patient has got COPD or chronic persistent asthma, because sometimes it is difficult to differentiate.
Okay.
Doctor, can you explain the role of the alpha 1 antitrypsin?
Yeah, alpha 1 antitrypsin is a thing which is basically formed in the liver, and this is a gene which is produces alpha 1 antitrypsin, and basically a trypsin and antitrypsin. These are two important aspects. Trypsin causes alveolar wall destruction. Antitrypsin prevents that trypsin to form the wall destruction, and this is balanced, kept into the balance. So alpha 1 antitrypsin deficiency, okay, in the patient, if it has, then the balance goes towards the trypsin, which causes the destruction of the alveolar capillary wall and the emphysema formation. So this is the trypsin-antitrypsin balance which is maintained, and the genes which is responsible over here is an alpha-1 antitrypsin gene. Okay, well, alpha-1 antitrypsin gene deficiency person will get very early COPD, especially emphysema. So younger patient with emphysema who are non-smoker can be, think about alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency. This is not uncommon, but we are not really going into the depth of it. We are not investigating. And the reason is that we treat this patient like a COPD. But yes, if you alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency, if you diagnose, you can give this alpha-1 antitrypsin to the patient and you can help them out. But there are expensive therapy. But there's a mixture of alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency can also happen. There may be partly deficient gene, may be partly heterozygous, and they may have a lesser amount of alpha-1 antitrypsin formation rather than complete absence of alpha-1 antitrypsin. So one can get at the later age also COPD because of the partially deficiency of alpha-1 antitrypsin. And this is also complicates with the smoker, it complicates with the asthma, and one can get emphysema in a patient. So this emphysema is generally seen in the lower lobes, okay, alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency patient, and lower lobe become hyperinflated, okay, while generally speaking, in COPD we get a lot of emphysema bulla in the upper lobes, okay. So this is some difference between the alpha-1 antitrypsin deficiency and this COPD we get in elderly people population get, while alpha-1 antitrypsin younger people can get the COPD-like feature, especially emphysema.
Thank you. Doctor, based on what you're telling us, is it difficult to diagnose COPD?
Not difficult to diagnose, but we miss COPD. That is sure. The reason is that COPD is diagnosed not by stethoscope. This is not an instrument to diagnose COPD. That's very important. COPD is diagnosed only by lung function test, spirometry. And what we do in spirometry, we will find out FEV1 upon FVC ratio. If it is less than 70, this is obstructive airway disease. And then we see what is his absolute FEV1 value compared to the normal FEV1. And we grade the COPD mild, moderate, severe as per that. So to diagnose COPD, we must have a lung function test or a spirometry test. I don't want to say lung function test completely, because lung function test there are a lot of things in lung function, like spirometry, lung volume measurement, diffusion capacity of the lung. Yes, all three are important to diagnose COPD, because diffusion is reduced in emphysema. which is also part of COPD. Lung volume measurement is also important because in COPD there is air trapping, so RV upon TLC ratio will be high. But most important test is that spirometry, which is very simple to do and it is cheaper than even X-ray chest. Okay, so you can get an obstruction there or not. Now you see, this is a graph which is shows the dark black color graph is a normal graph where we are seeing that FEV1 is almost more than 75%, or it is FEV1 over here. Okay, while the ground graph, you see, it is curved, it is little different. It is not like that. Your FEV1 values are significantly reduced here. This is seconds over here. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 on the x-axis is a time, and 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 on the y-axis is a volume of the lung. And so you can see the shape of the graph. Okay, a normal, which is dark black color, and gray color graph is a COPD graph.
And what is the ABCD assessment tool?
Yes, ABCD assessment tool is a new tool which is the last 3-4 years we are using it. If you see very carefully on the x-axis, there MMRC 0 to 1, CAT score less than 10. So this is symptoms on the x-axis. So if you have CAT score, is the scoring for understanding the patient's symptoms. If it is less than 10 or his breathlessness is 0 to 1, then that is one part. The other part is that when the MMRC, that is breathlessness scale, is more than 2 or CAT score more than 10. So these are the symptoms on the x-axis, and y-axis, there are 0, 1, not landing with the hospital admission. That is mild exacerbation. So these are exacerbation. Exacerbation means acute worsening of COPD. So if you have got 0 or no exacerbation or 1 but not requiring hospitalization, then it is labeled down. Okay, if you have more than 2 exacerbation or out of that more than 1 leading to hospitalization, you are graded up. Okay, so there are more exacerbations. So if you see A group has got lesser symptoms and lesser exacerbation. So this is something our treatment depends upon, this A, B, C and D. This is used for treating the patient. Okay, and not why it is important, because symptoms are important, and the next important, how many times patient require hospitalization. Every hospitalization or every exacerbation of COPD causes more problem to the patient. His lung functions are going to reduce gradually. His quality life is going to get reduced. His expenses is going to be more. Okay, so that is the reason we labeled this COPD, try to group the COPD by exacerbation and symptom. If you have more symptoms, you are going to requiring more medicines, and obviously his quality of life is going to be worse. So how will you treat? We never treat lung COPD by FEV1 value. FEV1 is a forced expiratory volume is used for diagnosis of COPD. But even if you have got very severe obstructive airway disease, FEV1 is very low, but patient may be in a group, that is, he may have lesser symptom and no exacerbation. This can happen. Or he may have more symptom but no exacerbation. He can be in big group B. Or some patients may have a good amount of FEV1 value. Say FEV1 will be around 3 liters. Very good. But he may have more exacerbation. So he will be in group C. Or the same patient may have more exacerbation also or more symptoms also. So he may go into the group D. So obviously group D is a worst. He will require a lot of medicines over here. Group C will require lesser amount of medicine. Group A and group B will require less amount of medicine. So we can actually find out what medicine should be given to A, B, C and D patient if we try to find out where our patient lies, which square it goes. Okay, and this is something which is a new GOLD guidelines guides us regarding the managing the patient. So COPD management depend upon the two important things: symptoms, how severe are the symptoms, and how many exacerbations one has. And with the combination of that, we treat the patient.
So what are the most common the COPD treatment goals?
Most common? What is
so the most common options for COPD treatment?
Yeah, the symptoms of the treatment option is one is first important thing is that all patients of COPD, they have to avoid exposure to pollutions and smoke. So smoking cessation is the first line therapy for all groups A, B, C, D. Reducing the exposure to indoor and outdoor pollution is also equally important to all these groups. Third is vaccination is important for all these group A, B, C, D. Vaccination means generally flu vaccination and in some patient pneumonia vaccination also. Health education is extremely important in all this group of patients A, B, C, D. Then pulmonary rehabilitation, that is very important. This is an important aspect of treating all COPD, especially COPD who are symptomatic. Symptomatic means who has got breathlessness, who has got cough, or who gets this patient are requiring, they need a rehabilitation. Rehabilitation itself is a huge thing, and there are a lot of aspects that Dr. Purvi is expert in this aspect. She will take care of this aspect of the therapy. But as well as the medicines are concerned, we treat the medicine as per the ABCD, and the A group will have only a bronchodilator, which may be anything like salbutamol or ipratropium. B group will have a combination of group, okay, long acting beta 2 agonist, or they may be given anticholinergic. Even the C group will be given anticholinergic, okay, and D will be have a combination of anticholinergics plus long acting beta 2 agonist together. Then he may also have inhaled steroids as a combination, theophylline like drugs and macrolides in some patients, and some antibiotics to prevent recurrent hospitalization in D group. So, in short, a single bronchodilator or dual bronchodilator therapy is for the milder patient, and for severe patient, we use the dual bronchodilator with or without steroids, inhaler, with sometimes theophylline like that is a drug that is which is another bronchodilator anti-inflammatory. We also give in some COPD, especially smoker, to prevent recurrent exacerbation by giving a small dose of macrolide, that is azithromycin or clarithromycin, for 6 months to 1 year. And pulmonary rehabilitation is given to all the patients who are symptomatic, who has got more symptoms. So group B will require, and group D, both will require, because they have a lot of symptoms. So they will be, their symptoms can be relieved, their quality of life can be improved, and their exacerbation also can be reduced by giving a pulmonary rehabilitation. So this is the line of therapy we follow.
So Dr. Purvi, can you please, unmute yourself.
Yeah.
Can you sort of just briefly tell us the benefits of rehabilitation for COPD patients?
Yeah. So Dr. Sheetal, there are many benefits about the pulmonary rehabilitation. Very first important thing is you'll get educated about your own disease. You'll understand what is a disease, because there is a patient education in pulmonary rehab. Second thing, you learn about the COPD medicines also, like inhalers, as doctor has prescribed. So they understand how to take the inhalers and medicines and nebulizers. And third thing, they improve the functional capacity. That means whatever breathlessness or dyspnea they are getting in their day-to-day activities, by doing different exercises and by doing this pulmonary rehab, they are more physically active, and they are strong in their body and mind also. It takes care of their emotional component, because it's a chronic disease. So because of the chronicity, it affects the psychological component. So when they take part in this rehab, pulmonary rehab, so it helps them to come out of that psychological issues, and emotionally also they improve by doing this rehab. And very important is there is a reduced hospitalization by doing this rehab. because their quality of life is improved, and that's why the number of hospitalization, number of uncertain visits to the doctors have reduced. That is a very important thing. And there is again different companies, like they understand how to manage small exacerbation. They can cope up with their disease. That is a very good improvement in their condition because of this pulmonary rehab.
And when should they start the rehab? Sorry, Shita. When should they start the rehab?
Yeah, doctor has already explained us that according to the GOLD guidelines, the PR should be offered to all the COPD patients who are in stage 2 or who has a greater severity. And other thoracic society and BTS also, ATS also, they recommend that clinicians should prescribe the PR for symptomatic patients, as the doctor has already explained us. Symptomatic patients who are FEV1 is less than 50%, or even if their FEV1 is more than 50%, but they are symptomatic, like they are having breathlessness or their exercise capacity is reduced, then they are referred for pulmonary rehab. And this pulmonary rehab can be started in a hospital, like when they are in exacerbation phase, inpatient, it is started in ICU in the form of a physiotherapy, like chest physiotherapy, and then slowly when they are in a subacute phase, so in outpatient setting also rehab is given, or at the patient's home also, like patients who are very fragile, who cannot come to a center, then that rehab can be started in their own home also. So basically it is very important if we start their pulmonary rehab post exacerbation phase, because that reduces the readmission chances and it improves their survival.
Can you give a couple of examples of what is included in pulmonary rehab so that people who are not used to the concept are, kind of aware what it means?
Yeah, so I'll just give example, like if patient is referred for pulmonary rehab by a chest physician, for that is a first step in a rehab. So
think she's lost her connectivity.
Yeah.
Dr. Prabhudesai, are you able to continue or do we switch the question
first,
to?
Well, no, first thing what she has said is correct. The reference has to be given to the physiotherapist for a pulmonary rehabilitation by a chest physician or by the physician. And why it is reference is important, because the patient is screened by the chest physician whether this patient is fit to undergo rehabilitation program or not. That is number one. Second, he has to know that his medical line of therapy he is taking regularly and properly, because medical line of... Purvi, are you on?
You're on mute still, Purvi.
Yeah, sorry. Yeah. There was a network issue.
Yeah,
sorry.
Go ahead.
So after the assessment, we decide their individualized exercise program. It's not a common exercise like, they have to do it. Everyone has to do the same exercises. So according to the patient's requirement, we plan their exercises program. And in that exercise program, there are different exercises, including breathing exercises, including their strengthening exercises, because their muscles are weak because of the chronicity. Then there is different, like we use different instruments. If it is in the center, we use treadmill, cycle for different exercises, and different instruments like few dumbbells and TheraBand. So there are different instruments in the center. By doing that, we give them different aerobic training and the strength training. And with that, we have counseling also, patient education sessions also. We make them understand, as I have already said, that they can understand the disease, what exactly it is, and how this rehab can help them. So slowly, they understand and they can cope up with the disease. And it is like a rehab program is of 6 to 8 weeks. When they do it this regularly, 6 to 8 weeks, then only they get improvement in all their components, like whatever breathlessness issues or whatever psychological issues, then you get the improvement. And this can be seen after doing the reassessment, like after doing their 1 month exercises, we reassess them and accordingly we plan their future program. I hope I have given you that.
Yeah, thanks. That's useful. I think one other question, because you brought the aspect that it takes 6 to 8 weeks before they will kind of probably see enough benefit. How do they stay motivated for such a long period of time?
Yeah, so a very nice question, Aparna. Now, because motivation is a very important part for the adherence to the programs, because it's a long program, 6 to 8 weeks regularly, they have to come thrice in a week to the center. It is a thing before the pandemic, I'm talking, but it is a big thing. So it was the issue. But what happens, you know, we have, that's where the assessment part is there. We assess their psychological status, how much they are motivated, and we find out their goal for joining the rehab. Like, you know, some examples, for example, few patients, they tell that I cannot go to the temple, I cannot climb the stairs of the temple.
Right.
So that's their goal. Like at the end of the rehab, they should be able to climb up that 4 stairs, 5 stairs without any breathlessness or with less difficulty. So we motivate with that small goal. And then after doing that 1 month of rehab, when we reassess, so we show them the objective measures that whatever, how much you have walked in 6 minutes, now you can walk more, you can, your breathlessness component is less. So those are the parameters which will give feedback, objective feedback to the patient that will also motivate them. And then slowly, slowly what happens, that, you know, they gain faith in the therapist of a rehab, in the rehab therapist. They gain confidence that I can do this. And then, you know, that faith and the confidence helps them to keep motivated to go on. We have, like in our center, we are running this center since last 8 years. And we have patients since last 8 years who are still coming to us. So
right.
Because of all that, our rehab team and their consistency, motivation, they are still going on.
Thanks. Before we move back to doctor for a few more questions, doctor, there's one question that's come in from the audience, trying to understand the relationship between COPD and lung fibrosis.
COPD is a obstructive airway disease and lung fibrosis is a restrictive airway disease. Means lung fibrosis is what is that there is a scarring in the lung. Okay. Lung is like a sponge. Okay. If you are pressing it, that is breathing out. You can see the air comes out of that spongy aspect of the sponge. And when you remove the pressure, the air also gets inside the sponge and the sponge expands. So this is like sponge. Okay. So in restrictive airway disease, especially fibrosis, if you put some little Fevicol or this sticky thing on the sponge, what will happen? The lung will get crumpled like that. So the sponginess of the lung gone. So you have lesser amount of air inside. So if you press, less amount of air goes inside. And when you open up, the less amount of air comes into the sponge. So this is like this. So this is a fibrosis. And emphysema is lung become inflated, hyperinflated. Okay, because of the emphysema, lung, the sacs become more and more in size. And they become emphysematous. Large. So COPD, obstructive airway disease, and fibrosis is used as a restrictive disease. The fibrosis leads to various types of fibrosis. The classical COVID fibrosis, what we call today now, or interstitial lung disease, what we call. Here, the fibrosis at in the interstitial aspects of the lung. Where in what is interstitium? It is a part of the area of the lung between the alveoli. Okay. So air comes from the windpipe, trachea, bronchus, bronchioles, terminal bronchioles, and goes into the alveoli. And then from alveoli, through that alveolar wall, the oxygen goes inside the interstitium area, between airway, the part between the lung alveoli and the capillaries, blood capillaries which are surrounded the alveoli. So this the oxygen enters from that alveoli, alveolar wall into the interstitium, then capillary wall, and then goes into the RBC. So this part of the, from RBC to the alveolar wall, okay, this is an interstitium, okay. So this interstitium, when get thickened, okay, it is called fibrosis or interstitial lung disease, okay. And this interstitium is not only to the area, but it goes up to the airway, sometimes the terminal airways. It may enter into the pleural aspects of the pleura also sometimes. So you have an entire pathology which is causes loss of lung volume and restriction. So this is interstitial. But obstructive airway disease, COPD, is where the windpipe become narrow and the alveoli are destroyed. Okay, they are little different. Okay, than the this thing, and the air becomes the lung become hyperinflated.
Thank you. Sheetal, are you going next?
Yes. So I wanted to come back to treatment, Dr. Prabhudesai. Can you tell us the difference between a nebulizer and an inhaler, and which is used when?
Yeah. So inhaler and nebulizer, they're all aerosol generating devices. Okay. So when we talk about inhaler, it's either a meter dose inhaler where there are fixed dosages inside that canister, and it when you press it, the flow of medicine comes out from that with the propellant. Propellant is a propellant material which is helped to bring out the medicine from the canister out. So this is inhaler. So when you press one, we get a fixed dose and which we know how much it is going. Say for example, salbutamol inhaler, if you are using it, then 100 microgram. If you are using steroid inhaler, then it may be 100, 200, 400 microgram. Okay. So we know that each puff will have some fixed dosages coming off that inhaler. So you may have either single inhaler or you may have multiple combination, two drugs together inhaler. You may have three drugs together inhaler also available. So this is called inhaler. And this in the form of meter dose, it's called inhaler, but you can also have a dry powder in the same way. But here in dry powder, you don't have to press, but you have to inhale by yourself. That is, you have to inhale like self-activating or actuating devices. Like that, when you inhale, then the powder goes inside the lung. Okay. So this is also inhaler device. So inhaler device is dry powder or a meter dose. Okay. It may be single, maybe multiple, maybe two, three like that. Maybe steroid and bronchodilator together also, if you can get it. Now, nebulizer is something, a nebulum is cloud. Okay. So it's a machine which forms the cloud of the medicine. Okay. So you have a larger amount of dose going to it. So you get a medicine in the form of mixed with the saline, either pre-mixed or you have to mix it and put it into the nebulizing chamber, and you attach a nebulizer to it. So it gives an airflow. Either air goes very rapidly and with high speed. When it goes through that chamber, the medicine goes into a cloudy form. Okay. And the patient can put it in the mouth, or he may put it in the nose and the mouth together, and he can quietly breathe with the normal breathing. Okay. While in meter dose inhaler, you have to inhale like that. In dry powder inhaler, you have to inhale like that. So in this nebulizer, you don't have to inhale. You have to just keep it. You take breath the way you are breathing, and you can constantly get the medicine inside by a normal breathing. It may take longer time. Inhaler takes short time. It means in the second the medicine goes inside, but much lesser quantity of dose. Here the large quantity of dose goes, but takes a longer time to go. So as the solution gets over, it generally the solution contains 2.5 milligram or maybe 0.5 milligram like that dosages. And here it's 100 micrograms, a small dose. So nebulizer is given to the patient who is breathless very rapidly or acute attack. Okay. So that he doesn't have to take this inhaler like that technique, because he cannot do it. He is acutely breathless. He cannot hold the breath, because in inhaler, you have to hold the breath for the medicine to settle inside. While in nebulizer, you can quietly breathe in and out, large number of medicine is wasted also, but large amount of medicine goes in the lung also. So both the things are possible with this. And this is a nebulizer. But nebulizer is also used not only for asthma, COPD, but you can give antibiotics also through nebulizer. So it's one of the method to deliver particles either in the form of bronchodilator, steroid, or even antibiotics inside the lung. Okay. We don't have any inhalers for the antibiotics available yet. Okay.
Right. And when are people put on portable oxygen therapy? And if you can explain the difference between when a cylinder is used versus when a concentrator is recommended.
Yes. See, oxygen cylinder is a, you have got a oxygen in that cylinder which is ready. It may be a smaller cylinder, it may be large, it may be jumbo cylinder which will last long. Okay. So this is an oxygen cylinder. It is very heavy, number one, and you have to, there is a valve over there, you have to open, and that is also very difficult sometimes. The leakages also can happen if your system is not properly done, and one can take the medicine through that. But remember, when you are giving 1 liter per minute oxygen, 1 liter, okay, continuously, the ordinary cylinder, which is of this much size, okay, will get over in 17, 16 hours. Okay. A smaller cylinder, even smaller period, 2 hours, 3 hours. Okay. If you are giving 2 liter, it will go further faster. If you are giving 3 liter, the entire cylinder can last for 6 to 8 hours. Okay. So it is for the shorter period. Okay. Number one. Second thing, the cylinder you have to change. So somebody has to come, bring the cylinder, rechange it, and go. So if your requirement of oxygen is high, then you have to have multiple times the changing system has to happen. So this is good for a patient who requires for a shorter period of oxygen. Okay. Say for a few hours while transport, you can use it. Okay. Or in the house, suppose patient is not going to survive for a long period of time. Okay. We can give this, we know that is a terminally ill sick patient. We can use a cylinder, which jumbo cylinder, you can use it, and you can use it for 3 or 4 days, 5 days, or it, we can change the jumbo. But oxygen concentrator is a totally different concept, where the machine takes the atmospheric air, remove the nitrogen from that, and whatever the remaining is oxygen. Okay, because generally oxygen and nitrogen, the two only important gases in the air. Carbon dioxide is a very small quantity. Okay, so when they purify the oxygen concentrator, what it does, it takes away the nitrogen and then gives an oxygen to the patient. That cylinders which are separating nitrogen out from that, the some part of the oxygen is given to the patient and remaining is left in that room. So that it should not happen that when you're using oxygen concentrator in one room, the person cannot sleep, the other person cannot sleep in the room, okay? Because you will, if the machine takes all air and oxygen, it not, but it doesn't happen like that, okay? Because it's only a part of it is given to the patient, remaining it goes to the, again, atmosphere. But that is electricity driven, okay? And you have got a flow meter over there, 1, 2, 3, 4, sometimes 5 liter, even some concentrators are up to 10 liter. So the stronger the machine, stronger is the thing, the oxygen can be given. And that, if you start it, electricity, it will be constantly working, okay, 24 hours. Okay, we generally give just rest for 1 hour to the machine, or maybe half an hour to the machine, and we continuously using it for days and days. Okay, so this is an oxygen concentrator which can be used at home for a long-term oxygen therapy. So it is, the terminology is long-term home oxygen therapy. Okay. So this is which we give with the oxygen concentrator. Now there are oxygen concentrators which also available for a portable. Portable in the sense, suppose I want to travel from my home to hospital. Now that is around 2.5 to 3 hours. Now I am breathless and I'm going to require oxygen constantly. I'm used to use oxygen at home. Once you are used to oxygen therapy, you feel uncomfortable if that oxygen is taken away from you, right? So you need oxygen while traveling. So during that travel, we give that oxygen to the patient by the portable oxygen concentrator. It may be 1 liter and 2 liter, or sometime very, you can give up to 3 liter also, but it's a battery driven. Okay, remember, there are batteries. Battery lasts for a shorter period of time. Then there are two types of oxygen concentrator. It's called continuous flow. Second is pulse oxygen. Pulse means what? During breathing in, only we are going to use oxygen. While breathing out, the oxygen is not used. So machine also understands this, and it gives oxygen only during when you breathe in. And when you breathe out, that time machine is shut. Okay. So obviously that time the battery usage is less. So these pulse oxygen concentrators they last long. And they are very good for COPD patient. Okay. But when patient is constantly breathing very heavily, okay, he may not tolerate that pulse oxygen. He may require a continuous oxygen. Like for example, interstitial lung disease patient, they will require a continuous flow and they feel comfortable with that. But again, if we are using continuous flow, the battery life becomes smaller. Okay. But then you have to have additional batteries, etc. So these are called portable oxygen machines, extremely useful. And they are used nowadays for traveling, even in the aeroplanes and airlines allow you to use oxygen concentrators inside. Now one can travel from here to United States, UK, wherever you want to go, and you can use that oxygen portable concentrators. You can charge these batteries, or even the battery chargers which are there. You can put in the car. Okay, how you charge your mobile in the car. Same way, these oxygen concentrators also can be charged in the car. So if they are traveling by car, they can travel constantly, long distance, they can take oxygen concentrator. So very useful device which has changed the management of COPD and ILD. And we made our patients mobile, which were actually not mobile earlier. They were remaining at home.
I think one question, we've got two questions actually, but let's start with the first one. You said pollution is one of the causes. So given that there is pollution, how, you know, does it cause flare-ups? Especially, you know, in the winter season, for instance, pollution goes up, right? So does it cause flare-ups, and what can patients do to prevent those flare-ups or exacerbations?
Pollution is a term. You may be knowing that pollution is season dependent, okay? Especially post monsoon, you have got less pollution because of the water, all the pollution levels are gone, okay? Lesser amount of pollution. But winter, yes, because of the temperature, etc., and all that, the fog gets accumulated and it contains a lot of particle material, a lot of gases, carbon, etc., and all that, and that will trigger the asthma as well as COPD worsening. Okay, and this is something is known to happen. That's why the exacerbation, that is worsening of the COPD asthma, is season dependent. Whenever the certain bad season comes. Not only that, if the pollution levels are extremely high, like for example, earlier, now this time there are lesser crackers, but earlier we used to have a lot of crackers, and during the cracker season, there used to be a lot of pollution. A lot of sandstorms used to come. That time there was a lot of exacerbation. And if the many other reasons are there for if there's a wood fire or a lot of big fire happening, especially in the jungles, the fumes can come to the cities far 100 miles away from that actually thing happening. So there's a pollution which can happen, and there's a more worsening of the asthma COPD. So certain things is preventable, certain things is not preventable. What is preventable? You can avoid going to morning walks and jogging when there's a lot of cloudy atmosphere, a lot of dust is there, pollution is there. Avoid going to walking in the traffic jams, especially in some certain areas where even the early morning you see a lot of traffic. Okay, so this can, traffic pollution is also very important. So you can avoid that. You can use mask. Okay, you must have seen during the lockdown period, there were no traffic. And obviously, your atmosphere was so clean, there was less pollution, and your sky was very clean. Okay, so you can make out that where our asthma patient hardly came. During that time, there was no COPD worsening, there was no acute asthma happening. So lesser amount of asthma COPD exacerbation we have seen. So definitely pollution has got a role to play in worsening of the patient respiratory status. Okay, so we can say that. Indoor pollution prevention is also equally important. I think avoiding the agarbatti and dhoop and making a lot of smoke in the house. We should have good exhaust in the house. So this is very important. And especially our village females and village people, they have to use the methodology for cooking, which is gas, carbon free, or you can say that biogas. We are free. So, okay, right. If they do it, then definitely there are chulas which are available. We are friendly, okay, as well as biogas is concerned.
Question for you, Dr. Purvi, what is the psychological help that patients need to get back to some kind of normalcy after a major exacerbation?
Yeah, so basically they lose their confidence that, you know, whether I'll be able to do my things, what I was doing initially. So that confidence is very important, you know, that should come back in that self-confidence. And the second thing is, that because of the chronicity, because they get this exacerbation many number of times, hospitalization in a year, there are patients who are getting hospitalized twice, thrice in a year. So that affects them, you know, because post-hospitalization, because of the immobilization and because of the disease chronicity, they get that weakness, fatigability, and they cannot do their normal things. So that affects them.
There's also anxiety, right? Because you're worried that it will happen again. So
yeah, so that is also there. And when they come to a rehab, when they are referred for a rehab, they are worried about the exercises, whether they'll be able to do those exercises. And that's why the patient education is very important. We have to make them understand that, you know, exactly how these exercises can help them, and that can help to reduce their hospitalization.
Right. But do you also, have you, in your experience, either of you, Dr. Prabhudesai or Purvi, have you also recommended that a patient see a psychological counselor at some point? You know, is that necessary, or is just the rehab therapist takes care of that element as well?
Well, COPD is also has got systemic manifestations. One is anxiety and depression. Okay, because of the, everything goes because of their immobility.
Right.
Because of they become non-social. Okay, they cannot do it. Okay, they cannot mix with the people, cannot enjoy the quality life. Once you start rehabilitation, 90% of the problems get solved once they start doing activity. And the physiotherapists are the best counselor for them. Okay, honestly, my experience for the last 7-8 years, we have hardly referred a patient for a counseling to a psychiatrist or a counselor, psychologist, okay? Because the everyday counseling helps, okay, when they are with the physiotherapist. So, but yes, if there is an underlying element of depression is there, okay, or an underlying element of anxiety disorder is there, which is different, it's by itself, okay, independent factor than COPD. Then we need a help of a counselor, and we need a help of a psychiatrist sometime. Okay, because sometimes this depression can lead to a very bad thoughts in the patient. Okay,
right.
In fact, that also can lead to their inability to join the rehab programs. Okay, that is also possible. So in these conditions, yes, we require.
Thank you. And Purvi, during the lockdown, have you all changed your methods of rehab? Are you offering online rehab? How is that working out as well for patients?
Yeah, so this, because of the COVID-19 pandemic and because of social distancing, we too had to, you know, shut down our center because of the government rule, and we had to shield or protect our more vulnerable patients, because these lungs patients are the vulnerable patient to get infected with the virus. So we had to shut down, but then also the need of rehab was there. So good news is, you know, we could immediately, we shifted our normal, conventional method of delivering rehab to the tele rehab. And yeah, it was challenging, but it was not difficult for us, because before the lockdown only, we were doing trials of this tele rehab. For that, you know, it was easier for our team to, it was a smooth transition from a normal rehab to tele rehabilitation. And then slowly, you know, it was now since 8 months, we are doing tele rehab for our normal COPD patients. And so it's a normal, new normal for them and all our therapist staff of pulmonary rehab, they are, and the patient, both of them are used to of this new mode of delivery of their pulmonary rehab. Yeah, initially it was difficult, but then we tried and tested different methods. So we came down to simple WhatsApp video call because the patients are old and, you know, they cannot log into Zoom and all these apps. So it becomes difficult for them. So we are doing just on simple WhatsApp video calls, this tele-rehabilitation, and we are doing it successfully.
Okay, thanks. Doctor, I think somebody's reacted to your point. So somebody says, I have to exert to breathe at night. Do I need some medicine before sleeping? Right now, I'm not taking any medicine for COPD. I think this person, if I'm a right, is also scleroderma and scleroderma, maybe even bipolar.
I've not really understood the question.
She's asking if she says sometimes I have to exert to breathe at night. Do I need some medicine before sleeping?
Yes. Yeah. Patients of all chronic lung diseases, chronic asthma, COPD, lung fibrosis, their night is generally more variable. Okay, by many reasons. One of the important reason is that the diurnal variation which happens in the airways. Okay, just like you have blood pressure varying in the morning, evening, night. Similarly, lungs also, the functions also variable between morning, evening, night, early morning, early late night, like that. And there may be a worsening of their symptoms, especially breathlessness can happen. So you have to modify your drugs. Okay, you have to see that you get a sufficient amount of drugs so that they will take care of that area. Second important thing, that worsening of breathlessness also happens because in the night when you eat food, okay, the stomach becomes heavy. So lungs and the abdomen is a compartment. Okay, so if your diet in the night, if you are not controlling your eating, generally what happens if you eat more in the night, the abdomen will get distended, okay, and that will pressure the compartment, leading to a pressure on this compartment of the lungs. So you are going to be more breathless, okay, than if you lying down immediately after eating food. And that's very important. If you are eating a large quantity, or if you take a diet which has got a bloating, okay, which causes bloating inside. Okay, so that can lead to more breathlessness. That is number two. Third thing is that when they are doing small activities at the day, borderline patient, they don't feel like breathless because they are active. In the night, they find that they are not doing any activity. So they are now mind sets up to their breathing. Okay, so yes, sometimes they feel breathless more. Okay.
Right.
All these, there are many reasons for that, and we have to understand the why the breathlessness is there and try to tackle every aspect of it. Okay, medicines, diet, nutrition, some breathing techniques in the night. Okay, so that the cool down, okay, the thinking has to be reduced, but they will think in the evening night more.
Right, and does the lying posture also make it worse?
Definitely. Okay, any posture, especially when you are lying down flat. Okay. Mm. Again, the whole compartment becomes one, and the whole abdominal pressure will come on the chest. Okay, plus your circulation also changes. Okay, in the lying down position,
right.
So your gas exchange is going to be different. Okay, so if it depends upon what disease you are having, there will be some physiological change happening in the lying down position, and it may be creating more problem. It generally do not benefit, but it creates more problem. That is
right.
What I say.
Right. Thanks. Couple of questions. One is on sleep itself. Why do I produce a lot of saliva in sleep, even when I'm using the concentrator at night while sleeping?
Saliva production is normally every time saliva is always formed. Okay. And that saliva we swallow unknowingly. Like that. Okay. So we forget that we are swallowing saliva. Okay, that is one. Second thing is that there are certain medicines also can give rise to more saliva formation. Okay, and certain medicines cause complete dryness of the mouth. Okay, so this also can happen. And especially during night. Second thing is that where the saliva goes into the esophagus and into the stomach. Okay, So if you have that swallowing issues, if you have got esophageal issues, okay, etc., they also responsible sometime for saliva not going into the esophagus and stomach, and it will start accumulating in the mouth and start falling down, okay, from the mouth. This can happen. These are sometimes more of a, they are not major issues, but yes, they are minor issues, so that can be managed. Dryness of the mouth is sometimes a major issue to the patient because that makes them uncomfortable. Okay. Mm. So that is one thing, because excessive saliva, you can put something here, and you must have seen a lot of children, small children produce a lot of saliva. Right. So there is a special thing mother does for that saliva. Okay. So that is manageable. Okay. You can modify medicines, etc. But dryness, if they have, okay, then they are much more and discomfort, especially the people who are mouth breather.
Mm.
They get a lot of dryness in the mouth and they are very uncomfortable that daytime. That is their major complaint, according to me, rather than excess salivation.
Right, right. And is dry mouth also linked to, I think, one of the treatment options is steroids, right? So is that also linked to steroids?
Dry mouth is if there are diseases where the salivation is reduced because of the autoimmune disorders. Like Sjögren's syndrome.
Right.
Okay. Or sometimes a condition like sarcoidosis, you have dry eyes, dry mouth. Okay.
Right.
Then yes, steroid, if you give them, then that improves. Okay. But not every dry. For example, if you are taking an anticholinergic drug, okay, like tiotropium, which is a very commonly used drug in COPD, it gives terrific dryness in the mouth. It means sometimes you have to stop the medicine because of dryness. Because it's anticholinergic, so it decreases the salivary secretion. Patient's mouth becomes dry.
Right. Okay. Yeah. Sheetal, you had something? I have otherwise a couple of audience questions coming in. So, go ahead.
Okay. So, very quickly, talking about steroids, there are a lot of side effects that are associated with steroids. Can you just briefly tell us the ones that you frequently encounter, and how are these monitored as well?
Yeah, every steroid is a double-edged sword. You know, it is very beneficial to many patients, but it also we have to pay the cost of that this thing by getting more side effects. Now, what are the side effects? The steroid side effects, so much I can talk an hour, actually. So the most important thing is that when you are taking steroids, it can give gastritis, acidity, hyperacidity. It can form an ulcers. It can worsen the existing ulcer. Okay, so that is one. Second, steroids can give rise to a bone problem issue. So it drives the calcium out of the bone. Okay, so that leads to very fragile bone. Okay, and if you are using it for a long period of time, then fractures are very common, especially the spine fracture, okay, which is a very important bone, okay, or a fracture of head and neck, the fracture of the hip joint, okay, very commonly seen fractures because of the steroid use. Third important side effect is that steroid is generally formed in the body, okay, and it is very important hormone, okay, hormone, or you can say that and the brain, the pituitary gland orders adrenal gland to form a steroid, and that steroid dose is required as per the need. Okay, for example, if you are under stress, suppose you have to catch a flight and you have to under stress, then obviously you require more steroid in the body. So this biofeedback mechanism is there. So pituitary is going to order the adrenal gland to produce more steroid. Okay, so like that. Suppose you have an exam, you are going to have more steroids. Suppose you get an infection, any infection, you require steroids, okay? Body has to produce more steroid. So there is this feedback mechanism is depend upon the lack of steroid in the body or need of steroid. If you providing outside steroid to the patient, okay, constantly, regularly, the habit of pituitary gland, because it will be to order the adrenal gland and adrenal gland to produce steroid, that is lost, okay? So if you withdraw that steroid out, the required steroid is not going to get formed. Okay, so you get a steroid deficiency. That's very important. That's a very important aspect, because lack of steroid in the body will give tiredness, fatigability, electrolyte imbalance, and many problems. Okay, So this is something is a side effect of steroid. If you are using for a long period of time, then you have to use steroid because you cannot be drawn up. That is the reason. So the osteoporosis, steroid suppression axis, gastritis, water retention, bloating, weight gain, moon-like face, excessive hair on the face, etc. These are all things can happen because of the steroid. So these are the some side effects of steroid. Glaucoma can get developed inside. Eye pressure can increase. Cataract can come. Okay, early. If anybody is going to get cataract at 60 years, he may get cataract at 40, 45 years. Okay, 50 years because of the overuse of steroid. Okay, diabetes, it can come. The steroid into diabetes, it can use more this thing. So a large number of Indian population, we have got diabetes. So if any person takes steroids, sugar is going to be very difficult to control. Or if he has no diabetes, or he is pre-diabetic, he is not really having diabetes, but there is a tendency in him to develop a diabetes. A steroid use causes a significant increase in the sugar level, and it is very difficult sometimes to control also. So these are some side effects of steroids. Plus, there are side effects from the skin. Skin become very papery. You can see a lot of bruises on the skin. Okay, that can happen. Okay.
Thank you.
So one question on the pollution. Actually, two questions. One is, of course, is an air purifier useful and effective at home? And the other is best time to go for a walk, because you talked about walk in the morning.
Air purifier are they are useful, okay, no question about it, okay, but it all depend upon the case to case. Not everybody should buy air purifier. Okay, suppose a person has got a severe asthma, okay, you can imagine that there is a severe asthma patient who requiring frequent hospitalization, etc. Air purifier may help them because it can reduce the density of the air, water from the this thing, so it makes the air little dry. So when the air is dry, the mites are less in the air, in the house. That's number one. So plus it also, there are some newer air purifiers, decreases the viruses, decreases the bacteria, decreases the fungi which are there on the walls. Okay, that some of the fungi can come into their sleeping environment, so that can be reduced. Okay, the air purifier can be useful. Especially if your house is near the traffic area and you have a lot of pollution, one can use air purifier because it reduces the suspended particulate material also to a great extent. So, depend upon what type of air purifier you are using, and their uses are there.
Right. Thanks. And the best time to go for a walk?
Well, I think I should not have excused that there is a pollution, that's why I can't walk.
Right.
The walking has to be done. And I will suggest it depends upon where you are staying actually and what is your area. So it all depends upon that.
Correct.
Now, if you are in Mumbai city where there's a pollution is more important, and then obviously during the winter season, I may tell you that you don't go in the early morning to walk, go later on. Okay. So otherwise, morning walking is always. Because when you do something in the morning and the day starts, okay, you are likely to do it. You can't do that. I will walk in the evening and you are busy and then you will not be able to walk. So that
right. Right.
I think they should start with walking.
Yeah. Sheetal, do you have any questions?
I had one question actually. What is assisted cough?
Purvi?
Yeah, assisted cough, we have to, we have to teach patient techniques with that, they can help, that technique can help them to remove the phlegm, which is, obstructed inside their airways. And so
this is usually morning time, is it, for patients?
For COPD?
For COPD? Yeah.
Most of the time, morning is a time when they are getting, because a whole night they are sleeping and there is
right.
No movement. And so the cough production is more in the morning. And sometimes we call this as a smoker's cough also, like in the morning they are having more cough. So there are different techniques. This is one of the techniques which helps them to remove the phlegm out of their airways and it comes to the central airways here, and then they can remove it easily. And with the help of, you know, sometimes we give the stimulation, tactile stimulation with the hands to the patient, and we tell them to, you know, cough, and we teach them the coughing technique, like you take a deep breath first and then you cough first, like, and then you do cough like that. Mm-hmm. So this is an assisted cough.
Thank you. Another term Dr. Prabhudesai came across recently was that a lot of COPD patients have some sort of digestive distress as well. And there was a term called COPD bloating. Can you explain that?
COPD bloating, I see, whatever I can tell you is like this, ki bloating of the abdomen, okay, gives a lot of discomfort to the patient. Their breathlessness increases very significantly, and they sometimes consult doctor for that. Okay. So the reason is that, ki, as I told you, that abdomen is a and a chest are a two compartment, and a diaphragm is a in between. Okay. So if I press one compartment, this compartment get some pressure. Okay. If we reduce the pressure over here, this compartment pressure also reduces. So a patient who gets constipation, patient who eats a lot of food which is gives a lot of gas formation, bloating, the abdomen will get bloated, okay, and they get distended. The colon will be bloated, the intestine will have a lot of gas, stomach may be having gas, okay, because of the various reasons. And then this pressure is indirectly goes into the chest, okay, leading to discomfort in the chest. So this is called COPD, and this COPD are much more affected by these because they have got a very tight diaphragm. Okay, the movements of the diaphragm is very lesser, okay, compared to a normal person. So they will have much more bloating effect than a normal person. Okay, and especially this may happen in the night, and as you rightly found out, you are told in the lying down position that will be more. So they will not be able to. So they need a special diet. So dietitian has to advise them the correct diet. They has to take a lot of fiber to reduce the constipation. Okay, and they have to be told about the eating habits. Okay, how you should eat the good calories food, good protein, but less quantity. Okay, so that small quantity, the smart eating is called. Okay, so they have to learn that smart eating at COPD, which provide them good proteins and calories, but less quantity.
So is there a specific diet, sorry, for all COPD patients?
Yes, all the patients in pulmonary rehabilitation program, the nutritionist consult is taken. And it's very important that they have a good body mass index, okay, BM, what we call it. Okay, BMI. Okay, the reason is that COPD patient, as you have shown in a slide, that they will lose weight. Okay, large number of patients lose weight. Okay, but there are some people who are obese also. Okay, and who are COPD. So we have to see that the obese patient should come to a normal body weight, and the malnourished patient should improve their nutrition, and they should have good body weight, and also they should have good muscle mass. Okay, so that's very important. So they need a good class protein. So all these COPD patients, and especially if without diet advice, if you continue exercise program from a rehabilitation program, they will going to further lose weight. Okay, so this is so important that after the physiotherapy component, or that is exercises, and is a very important component of rehabilitation. The second important component of rehabilitation is nutrition therapy. It's so important.
I think we are kind of over time. Sheetal, do you have any other question? I have one final question that I've received from the audience.
No, go ahead, please.
So we were not trying to focus on COVID, but there is a post-COVID patient who says, I'm suffering COPD symptoms. I just wanted you to clarify, doctor, are they more likely to be fibrosis or COPD symptoms? And, you know, are these curable or permanent?
Uh, See, COVID can happen to COPD also. Okay. COVID can happen to...
No, the question is, you're already, you have COVID. Can you get COPD as a result of COVID?
No.
No.
At least...
so far,
not
what
COPD,
we
know. But yeah, but they can have a fibrosis. They may have little hyperreactive airways, sometimes more cough. But it is not a permanent thing to happen in COPD. The cough will go afterwards. Fibrosis also, some of the majority of the patient, they will come out of that scarring, because every infection always follows scar, a healing. Okay, so that healing may take some time. Sometimes it takes time, but not every patient will be will completely come out of that. Some patient develops a fibrosis, which is very difficult to treat and maybe progressive also. So.
Right. Okay.
And when the vaccine comes out, should COPD patients take the COVID vaccine?
I think COVID vaccine is going to be taken by everybody. COPD, everyone. Definitely. Okay. ILD also, the healthcare workers also, elderly people population also, and so it will be given to everybody. Maybe I don't know whether pediatric patient, they will be given vaccine, because their COVID is generally mild and they don't get complications. So those group, this is my feeling, I'm not very sure about it, but barring that group of young kids, okay, I feel COVID vaccine should be given to everybody. Now, one may say that the children, they are not suffering, but they transfer infection to others. Okay, so that is something which. So whether that vaccination will be effective in preventing a COVID transmission from the children, we don't know. Their disease may be prevented, but they may carry COVID infection from their throat and mouth. Okay, and hand. Okay, so they may spread. So I don't know whether that will prevent vaccinating children will prevent elderly people to get less COVID. I don't know about that, but the most important people who require is healthcare people, okay, because they are more exposed, elderly people, and all cardiovascular and respiratory diseases patients, malignancy patients.
But there is, if it is a live vaccine, would that still be okay? Because I know, for instance, transplant patients and those on immunosuppressants.
Live vaccines are, they will not be really... One has to study about them. Yeah,
right.
I don't know. The safety is very important of that, especially in the immunocompromised patients.
Right. Okay. Thank you, doctor. And thank you to our audience. Thank you, Dr. Purvi and Sheetal. So I think we've had a very interesting discussion, very informative. We've got a lot of good questions as well from our audience. So thank you for taking your time on a Saturday afternoon to do this.
Thank you.
Thank you
very much.
Thank you.
And I appreciate your efforts, ma'am. Thank you.
Thank you, doctor.
Thank you.